Ashish asked us to do this paper together. I tried to write the theoretical part of the paper, which is the longer part, and Ilango contributed from his experience in Kutumbakam and in Tamil Nadu, the practical part. So we will speak accordingly. I'll speak for about 10 minutes, and maybe after that Ilango can explain what they achieved there and his vision for a possible future based on that sort of learning. Yesterday we had a lot of conversation about boundary conditions, and I think it's important to clarify what the boundary conditions of this paper are so that we can have a good discussion. The way I understand our predicament, and when I say our, I mean all humanity right now, our predicament today is that some people's illusions have become other people's realities, and their fantasies are having huge real consequences for the rest of us, as well as occasionally for everybody. And so the most sort of inexorable example of that I find today is climate chaos. Climate change is a euphemism for what is coming. It's climate chaos and climate instability and unpredictability, which is throwing so many societies out of gear. So I like to think of climate change not as another environmental problem, but as the very setting for all the other environmental, social, human problems taken together. So I think that that gives us strategically in public arguments a very important touchstone of discussion, that if we start with inexorable climate change and all that needs to be done in order to address it, a whole lot of other things follow from that and will give us a better perspective. So that's my sort of primary boundary condition for this paper. There is an enormous power that we are finding, which we should have known all along, is there in non-human agency, one can call it, which is to say when you flirt with the elements write back in profound ways. So whether it's the storms or the floods or the tsunamis and so on, there is a sense in which non-human nature reacts upon humanity. Whether or not you agree that we live in the Anthropocene, that's not relevant, I think, here. That would be my starting point. Then I also take as a given that we live in a time not of crisis anymore, but of collapse. So the collapse is happening all the time. It's a bleeding giant. And the question is when the giant itself or some critical element within the giant recognizes that it's no longer there. So therefore, whatever arguments one proposes, whatever visions one conjures up, whatever imagination one brings to the table, it must ready itself for moments of opportunity which will arise literally every day from now until the time being time. That's the sense in which I've been thinking about these issues. The other boundary condition, and this addresses something that Sharad was mentioning yesterday about the future not being Adivasi. I personally believe if there is a future, it's closer to the Adivasi end of the spectrum than the American end of the spectrum. The idea that everybody can live on an American standard of living on a planet like this is absurd. The idea that everybody must live, therefore, on the Adivasi standard of living is equally absurd. Now, where in the middle are we going to find ourselves, and whether everybody will find themselves in the same place, I don't think that's necessary. So we need a vision of plural futures. And so one needs to say, for instance, I'm not necessarily going to live like an Adivasi. I cannot, given my inheritance, given my background history, so many things, I cannot. But that does not mean that so many millions of others who are living sustainable lifestyles in their habitats should not have the freedom of, for instance, deciding what their occupation should be. An old woman in Saurashtra, in the Ukai Valley, where Ukai Dam, they're building Ukai 2 now, said this to me some years ago, what right do people in Delhi have to decide whether I should do farming or something else? And fair enough. So that's the point, that you know, one tends to assume that what I am advocating for, let's say somebody else, is the same thing I should be doing for myself, and that's not a good way to reason in the predicament which we are in. The last one, as far as boundary conditions go, is that Mrs. Thatcher was indeed right when she said there is no such thing as society. She was right for her cultural context. Oops. Sorry, I should really go on to talking about what I meant to talk about.
That's an important point. Finish it.
There are only 3 minutes of my 10 left.
Was that Oops? Was it about Margaret Thatcher?
Please. No problem.
Now, the globalization is actually a euphemism for increasing centralization. That we understand. What that means is that everybody is now living in a remote-controlled economy. Nobody is living in an economy where face-to-face decisions are made in contexts where people are actually living, working, etc. Something is decided on one continent, the consequences are experienced on another one, etc. The urbanization of the mind that follows from all the things that we've been talking about has enormously deleterious ecological consequences, both on the part of the rich as well as on the part of the poor, for different sets of reasons. Now, vision of renewal is what I call it, India in, say, the 2040s, and I don't think just of India in the 2040s, but the world as a whole. Now we are condemned to thinking of the world as a whole. There is a certain road to localization and regionalization which is possible. I believe it requires a lot of undoing, a lot of unlearning, and a lot of reimagining what the meaning of life itself is. If climate stability and ecological renewal are our foremost goals, then I believe one needs to think of intermediate institutional arrangements for curbing the speed and the scale of growth that has been happening. That's one. Secondly, there has to be, like we were discussing yesterday, much more careful ecological pricing of energy. The end of energy subsidies in the mainstream fossil fuel-based economy. Decentralized production and consumption of energy, things which we were talking about yesterday. There needs to be a complete revolution in human settlement patterns. And this can come about quite quickly if the right kinds of tax incentives and subsidy incentives are created. Carbon taxes, but also carbon subsidies. There has to be a deurbanization and a reurbanization of a different kind, which if we have time in discussion, we can go into. There needs to be ecologically sound technology, which sort of humanizes the process of production. I think of it as eco-facture as against machinofacture or robotized machinofacture. There needs to be, in our context in India, the recovery of what some people call Lokvidya, which is very different, as I understand it, from indigenous knowledge. There needs to be a restoration of work, especially to women. Whole areas of work have been taken away from women in the imperialism of the last 3 centuries or so. There needs to be attention to small credit. Nowadays, the tendency is that you know, you have big banks who are not interested in small credit because of the transactions cost involved, and so everybody wants to become big, so the small always gets left out. So if we are thinking of a new kind of economy which is renewable, one needs to think of small credit and how that is to be administered, and I don't mean microfinance. And finally, there needs to be creative thinking about marketing networks beyond the local and the regional. Now, before I hand over to Ilango, what I'll say is that while self-sufficient villages have always been a mythical construct, self-sufficient regions are not. And eco-regions, bioregions can indeed become viable economic units with adequate democratization from the grassroots.
Good morning. By seeing what's happening outside, I'm Ilango. I'm basically a chemical engineer. Sometimes I was a scientist, and now I contested in the panchayat, resigned the job, and went back to my village to Kalpavriksh. Became the panchayat president of the village. 10 years I was as a panchayat leader. Then after that, I started, when it's possible in my village, why not in other villages? And I started working more and more panchayats in Tamil Nadu. Right now, I may be having, and I have more than about 700 panchayats in Tamil Nadu in my network. And trying to replicate, when it's possible here, why not in your village? Why not something like this? It's going on well, very well. In that process of first understanding the administration, economics, governance, larger governance, local governance, all these things. My technical background also, I invest in the village development. And after that, I understood the small is beautiful and small technologies. And the confidence, this 20 years of my struggle in the villages in Tamil Nadu, the confidence is, one side, the aggressive invasion of the outside influence of the economics or whatever, policies or whatever. Still, in reality, villages, still 70 to 80% of the villages, the hope is there if you sensitize the community with a good leadership, a transparent and that sort of leadership, and results are coming. People are able to see the result, and there is enormous possibility of reversing the community. One thing is that they have to see the result. So that sort of thing. So after the assumptions or the practical difficulty is, all the panchayats are like Kalpavriksh. That's again a question. How many panchayats are transparent? How many panchayats are capable of planning? How many panchayats are really sincerely contacting the Gram Sabha? How people are involved? These are the questions. But my humble thing is, it has to happen. It's a constitutional mandate. People have to do it. The professor has to do it, the government has to do it. It's not happening. But if it's not happening, is it, are we really sure that we will discard that and find an alternate system? That sort of question. For that, I try to work with the panchayat. And my panchayat, it can be, anyone can come and sit there and study the whole concept of 73rd Amendment, people, participation, technology, small, everything happened. Then around me, then I started networking more and more panchayat. Then I arrived, if 20 to 30 panchayats, a population size of about 1.2 to 1.3 lakh population, if they join together, and this, it becomes a sizable economic zone. The consumption is there. Then interesting part of the rural side is, more than consumption, apart from consumption, the production is also there. There is rice, there is dal, there is something. And in our research, we have found, in practical research, we have found about 40 to 50, maximum 40 commodities, the whole life of the villages are going on. 40 commodities. Out of that, in these 25 to 30 villages, certainly 80% of the commodities can be, it's available. And the processing, the market, how the market is exploiting them, people are very tired and very clearly watching for some solution. So when there is a modern rice mill, then I modified it, broke it, and again made it as a small rice mill, which is, even with 10 lakh rupees you can operate a viable business rice mill. Then there is huge demand for the rice mill in the villages. Then when you downsized it, automatically the power consumption and all these things, the requirement, everything comes down. So like that, oil, the larger oil mills, but actually the reality is, people know that the till is, we are cultivating till, we are cultivating groundnut, we are cultivating copra, everything, but I am buying the oil day by day, oil I am unable to control, that sort of vigor is there with the people. If some technology is going there, viable, then automatically people are prepared to throw that oil outside and they are prepared to buy this. One. Then the taste and the, now the achi masala has come for sambar masala. But you just go there, then the village people also started, they are pressurized by the market and the people are buying the masala. But one day when you call a Gram Sabha, then you cook the masala, market masala sambar, then ask the favorite four or five ammas to make their own sambar, then the whole village is prepared to throw this masala out and prepared to come. This is the reality. So that's why I see that. But the assumption is, how many panchayats, how many grams of us, that's the question. But I think it is not impossible thing, I feel. Because being a villager, when you go on, that's why now out of 600, 700 panchayats, anywhere I go, oh, Ilango sir, oh, Dingedana, you are that Ilango. Sir, sir, come sir. That is there. Even from Tamil Nadu, then when I go to Andhra Pradesh, then oh, you are that Ilango. That sort of thing is there. So then with this, when we see the aggressively all the problems you discuss and the country is discussing, and the inner strength of the community, the village is there, then they again the real value production capacity of the capability of the villages, somehow if something is worked out, and certainly it is possible to, for that only I have chosen that community villages network, and I am trying to, and technology also, I travelled across the country, even part of the world also, and modified the technologies in such a way. Now out of the 40 to 50 commodities, easily 30 to 40 commodities can be produced in a small way in a very, very good viable business model. So using that, I call that network economy is the sustainable economic zone of 25 to sustainable economic zone. I openly challenge in any forum, this is a sustainable economic zone. Whether dollar fails or rupee fails, I mean anything fails, my sustainable economic zone will not fail. So that sort of thing I share there.
Ilango, I want to ask you if you have similar kind of technology for converting cotton into handloom into yarn and cloth. Do you have a big cotton growing part there in your network?
No, that's I am part of your thing. So cotton means Uttaraman.
The word is not used in presentation, but in abstract the word self-sufficient is used. So whether you want to say self-reliant or self-sufficient is my question. Self-sufficient is a bit too much to say for me. Secondly, what have you done with the caste gender structure of every village? I don't see that these villages are Adivasi or anything. They are caste-ridden and patriarchy-ridden villages. There is going to be differences in land ownership, etc. also. So, how you deal with that in self-sufficient or self-reliant economy, whatever you might decide to call it. And if it is self-reliant, then it is a question of how much migration is there from these villages, or it is getting reduced or not. So before this kind of thing started, supposing there were 100 people going to the big cities or anywhere for employment and they are coming back, etc. What is the process which is reverse of migration is there or not? Yeah,
mine was a similar question. Aseem, there's a tendency to romanticize localization. Right? I mean, just saying localization doesn't mean that we solve all the problems. The issue of caste discrimination has been raised. The whole issue of land grabbing, the whole issue of the abuse of environmental human rights standards. So I think, Ilango, your case is very, very important to say how can you overcome that? I mean, if you have a big multinational or big Indian company coming in, I mean, how do you stop that from happening, and how do you stop the inherent discrimination that is there within the communities and the inequitous land ownership and so on? So I think that would, if localization is so important, what is the role of the state? What is the role of the state at the regional state level, and what is the role of the state at the central level? What would be the ideal role of the state?
Taking it from where Milu left it, I just want to be, I'm curious as to, is there any inbuilt institution of conflict resolution within the panchayat and within your network? And do you see that their success in terms of resolving that conflict, because, you know, I mean, there is potential for conflict because of various costs coming together. But do you see that, you know, some costs opt out of it because they don't want to participate in it? And do you think that, you know, there are certain communities which are more eager to join such a network and some are not? And on that point, Aseem, if you think the trajectory is towards the Adivasi model, then does that bring in its own, you know, possibilities of conflict? And how do you think that conflict could be resolved? Because, you know, there is so much pressure from, you know, market forces to impose a certain value system on people.
I wanted to understand how are the relations of production and relations of resources and use conceptualized by you in the course of the type of productive forces that you are trying to unleash. Some more questions have been already raised, so I won't repeat them, but let me add to my dimensions. Are you introducing planning in any possible way? Or is it that the relations among these people are still mediated through market? And if you have planning in mind in this for the 700 panchayats, that networks that you have thought, how are these networks actually? These are market, these are really planned networks. Okay? Just adding to the gender, caste, variety of other dimensions, capital, labor, it would be also involved, land, variety of things are involved in that. Second, how do you envisage really the, let's say, rice mills, which are capital goods, to be produced and manufactured, and who will produce them? How is it envisaged as far as it's concerned? Because a lot of surplus value actually passes through this kind of, control over technology, control over... Are you the node? I do think that you are the vanguard, or you are the... How are you envisaging the future? Because you are building on something.
And interestingly, it's a self-sufficient, more than self-sufficiency, it's a self-reliant zone, in fact, I can say. Because the community is so self-reliant, and out of the 120 crore population, the Delhi, Madras, or whomever, you may be 5 crore, 100 crore people without anything, we are self-reliant, the village people are self-reliant. So that's why it's a self-reliant, that self-reliancy-based whole movement economy, what I'm trying. And the caste and other things are there. If a strong leader, a village leader, or, you know, the community, something like that. That's why the question is, how many people are in Ilango, or that sort of question is there. But if you involve, out of 12,600 panchayats in Tamil Nadu, 2,000 panchayats are categorized casteist panchayats. Rest 10,000 panchayats are there. Out of that, I can say that 5,000 outstanding panchayats are there. The caste is there. It's not a big issue. You can sort it out. But what is the blanket effect should be technology or development or the prosperity. If that happens, people are prepared to give that face by face. My village was a casteist state village, one of the casteist village, which made me come back and work there. Now it has become the model for the country, which became the first Samantopura. Karunanidhi learned the whole concept of Samantopura from Kutambakam. So it is not like straight away I started talking the theory. I started demonstrating so many things. After that, upper caste, lower caste, all the people, they came together and they started living. Now the Samantopura, every alternate house is a Dalit house. One Dalit house, one Brahmin house, one Dalit house, one Naidu house. So 100 families are living together. Yeah. So like that, when we try, that's why I humbly say that with all your intellectual and commitment and all, there is a possibility. What if there is a possibility? What if there is a possibility if we work together? And certainly there is a possibility, and we can sort out all these things.
But it is not the question of living together, but it is a question of structure.
Okay, I think we can carry on the remaining discussion later. I think Ilango has answered very well the question of how do you deal with social inequities in a rural situation. It's not to be done in 5 minutes in a seminar. It has to be done in practice through a whole set of different experiments. So I'm not going to go into that now. What I do want to say is, in response to
we lose question about if localization is so important, then what is the role of the state? And I'm going to answer it obliquely by saying that actually the state needs to back off a lot. We have left things to the state, which not only is the state not capable of doing, it's going to aggravate matters in profound ways if it takes on those tasks. And this, I go back to Mrs. Thatcher now, I have a moment. It's very important that we understand the difference between this civilization and that one. In that one, the state is the center of gravity of society, as Rabindranath said. You know, in India, that is not the case. In India, the biradari is still the primary mode of social identity, which is why so many class struggles have failed, because people have failed to realize how important biradari and jati is, and jati is different from caste, I will insist here, for certain
purposes. Okay, speaking of Haryana into account, biradari is what they're done.
Can I finish? There has to be an intelligent way to speak about a community. I'm afraid the moment you mention community nowadays, my subaltern historian friends will start thinking of cows. That's not the only community we know. I know 1,000 other kinds of community, and you know as many. So we need to bring that whole discourse about community back into the picture for one very simple reason. Other than its purpose within human society, which is profound, ecologically, we can't tackle things today through remote bureaucracies or through corporate bureaucracies. Both will remote control things and destroy the environment. The only way you can protect the environment is through regeneration of community, howsoever imperfect they might be in the interim, and we have to think of ways of conflict resolution in practice.